welcome, everybody. I hope everybody can find a seat. I'm sure you will agree with me, it's been an extraordinary day so far, and we haven't even finished. And I wanted to start, actually, with this map here. This map shows the 25 other locations that an Earth Optimism event is happening right now, and that's not including outer space. So we've looked at a lot of different approaches to conservation so far and heard how it's succeeding in many ways through a variety of different solutions. And I think you'll agree that everybody who has talked so far has been amazingly inspiring. And we've got some even more inspiring talks to follow now. And the first speaker I'd like to introduce is Mike Hoffmann. He's been pioneering some work on how to really find out and ask that really tricky question, is conservation succeeding? And he's going to tell us the answer. Thank you, Mike.
Thank you, Rosie. Well, it's wonderful to be here this evening, and I'd like to start by paying a big word of tribute to all the people who've made today possible. I'm just coming from a similar series of events taking place in London, and well, it truly is a week of optimism. Now, I'm sure I speak on behalf of Debbie and Tony when I say that we'd probably both have given up, or all of us given up, our 15 minutes of fame if we could have heard Sir David talk for an hour. Unfortunately, you have to put up with us. I guess it's not every day you get to tee up a legend, right? So, what I'd like to do is I'd like to start off with a little story, and I'd like to take us to a part of the world which, round about January, February, those of us who live in the UK start thinking about, the tropics. Specifically, I want to take us to the island of Bali. Blue skies, beaches, sunshine, cocktails, those are all the things you kind of think about when you think of Bali. About the last thing you think about is this little fella. This is the Bali starling, or the Bali miner. It's the only species of vertebrate that is endemic to the island of Bali, and it's so revered, in fact, that it's featured on the 200 Indonesian rupiah coin. Now, this is an interesting little bird because, even when it was discovered over 100 years ago, it was never very common. Around about the 1900s, there were probably only about 1,000 individuals, and they were mostly found around the northwestern part of the island. But over the last 100 years, they've undergone a pretty significant population reduction. And now, they're found just there in their native part of the range. Tiny, tiny part of the island, far in the northwest, called West Bali National Park. And there's about 60 individuals surviving in the wild. And then they're also found, introduced, that's not part of their native range, a tiny little island off the coast. And the reason for this quite significant population reduction is really down to one thing: hunting and trapping for the cage bird trade. And this is a rather insidious threat which has been affecting a lot of the songbirds across the Southeast Asian region. In fact, the issue became so severe that in 2001, there were only 6 of these birds left in the wild. Now, the good thing is, of course, they do well in captivity. That's why they're held as cage birds. And in fact, if you go to some of the zoological gardens here in the UK, like Chester, you can see some of these birds in captivity. And fortunately, conservationists were able to take some of these birds and reintroduce them and therefore augment the wild population. But notwithstanding those efforts, the population has remained relatively low and has continued to fluctuate. And 20 years ago, BirdLife International assessed the species as critically endangered. And as you can see, despite all of those efforts, well, not much has really changed. Today, it's still considered critically endangered on the IUCN Red List of Threatened Species. Right, so 20 years plus of conservation action, and well, nothing to show for it. We're just not making a difference. And this is the story that plays out on a daily basis. We've heard it all before, and it's kind of the story that typifies our worldview of conservation. So yes, we have the good news stories, right? this sort of thing. New protected areas, new species discoveries, a new piece of legislation that's been passed to help protect a threatened species or to help control illegal wildlife trade or invasives. And the problem with this sort of story is that it seems that for every one of these, there's six or seven bad news stories. So maybe it's species we thought were common suddenly becoming threatened. Maybe it's charismatic species, yet another story about a charismatic species going down the tubes. Top-level predators, high-level predator populations collapsing. Some insidious threat that we didn't know about that's suddenly emerging and decimating wildlife populations. Or just, you know, general bad news. Everything is going one direction to hell in a handbasket. And the sum of all this is that people feel like, well, we're buggered, really. There's nothing we can do. And this is something we as conservationists have helped feed. We've helped feed this narrative that it's all doom and gloom. No matter how hard you try, no matter what you do, we're just not able to make a difference. Right. Well, I'd like to try and change that worldview a little bit. You see, we spend a lot of our time looking at what the situation is today and then comparing it with some point in the past and looking at the difference between those two things and saying, well, this is a measurement of our impact. So let me give you an example, and it might seem sort of a facetious example, but actually it's a real world one. Let's look at elephants. 10 years ago, there were probably 500,000 elephants surviving across the continent of Africa. And if the world was perfect and we lived in a nice, wonderful world that we'd all like to live in, then today there would still be 500,000 elephants. Unfortunately, the world isn't perfect, and it's not the nice place we would like to live in. And so actually, there aren't 500,000 elephants. There are probably around 400 to 410,000. And we think to ourselves, wow, that's pretty grim. And it is, right? I mean, this is a species which has been listed on CITES for 20, 30 years. This is a species that has immense amount of conservation action and funds going into it. This is a species found in numerous protected areas across its range and has probably more people working on it than most other species, and yet we still lost nearly 100,000 elephants. That's pretty grim, right? But here's the thing. What we're not asking is what would that situation look like if there was no CITES, if there were no protected areas, if all those people out there working on elephants and fighting for the causes of elephants weren't doing what they were doing. Well, the odds are it would look a lot different. And this difference between what we observed happened and what we think would have happened if we hadn't been doing conservation action, that is also the impact of conservation action. So let's go back to our Bali starling, right? There he is over there. So if there hadn't been this captive breeding and reintroductions and all the rest of it, the odds are this species wouldn't be critically endangered. Almost certainly that species today would be extinct in the wild. And it's not the only one. A couple of years ago, BirdLife International led a study to try and understand how many critically endangered bird species would be extinct or extinct in the wild if conservationists hadn't been doing all the wonderful things that they're doing. Reintroductions, artificial breeding, nest site provision, active protection on the ground, all of those sorts of things. How many species would have gone extinct? And they found that besides the barley starling, a further 15 species would have vanished. Vanished entirely. And they include some charismatic species like the California, China's crested ibis, New Zealand's black stilt. Now, conservation doesn't only work to avoid extinctions, right? It also works to help ensure that common species stay common. It works to ensure that those wide-ranging, relatively abundant species, like the passenger pigeon, don't suddenly go sliding towards extinction. And that is the crux. Those avoided extinctions, those avoided losses, are the forgotten gains of conservation action, right? But, crucially, conservation action also drives recoveries. Now, Debbie, in her presentation, is going to get into a few more of these. I'm going to touch on a couple of them very, very quickly. On the left, the large blue butterfly, this is a species that went extinct in the UK. It's a local extirpation in the UK, 1979. And then it was reintroduced. It was reintroduced taking stock from Sweden in the early 1980s. And it only survives in a very small part southwest of England. But over time, you can see you don't have to worry about any of the axes of the graph. The only thing you need to have a look at is the trend. And over time, you can see that even though it's remained very focused and narrowly distributed in range, that population has slowly begun to increase. Yes, it's going through population fluctuations, but it is very slowly starting to increase. The species that vanished, the species that went extinct in the UK, is now on a path to recovery. Mauritius kestrel. I could have picked any one of a number of species on Mauritius, and Debbie will probably flag up a few more. This species, in the mid-1970s, there were only four individuals surviving in the wild. And then, actually largely through the sheer bloody-mindedness of one individual, a gentleman by the name of Carl Jones, who sadly can't be here today, this species staged one of the most dramatic recoveries. And it now numbers several hundred individuals surviving on the island of Mauritius. And I picked it actually just because I wanted to sort of flag up that it's not yet out of the woods, but you can nonetheless see that over the last 30, 40 years, it has undergone a very substantial population increase. And then finally, perhaps one of the best examples of conservation success story, the southern white rhino. At the end of the, or at the turn of the last century, there were probably less than 200 individuals of white rhino surviving in the wild, mostly confined, in fact, nearly all confined to a single protected area, Shishlui Mfolozi in South Africa. And then through a number of rather insightful measures, mostly focused around translocation and relocation to new protected areas, this species staged arguably the most dramatic recovery of a species anywhere, going from that very, very small number of individuals in the early 1900s to nearly 20,000 individuals today. Now, there are two lessons I want you to take home from this. The first is that, I specifically picked the Mauritius kestrel and the rhino because, as you can see, both of them, and we hear this, we know this from the news stories that we hear every day, neither of these species are out of the woods. And that's a key conservation message, that even when you drive population recoveries, the odds are that many of these species are going to remain conservation dependent. You can't just take the foot off the pedal. You've got to keep those efforts sustained. And the second thing is that conservation actions have to be sustained. They must be sustained. These things have taken place over 30, 40 years. Now, of course, one of the things that people often say is that, you know, well, okay, you've got to be investing for 30, 40 years. But it doesn't always have to be like that. In the case of the island fox, this is a species that occurs in the Chaland Islands off the coast of California. This species underwent a dramatic decline during the 1990s, during the mid-1990s. And nobody knew what it was. And eventually what happened was they figured out that what had happened is that feral pigs and deer had been introduced to these islands from the mainland. And then what had happened is that they'd attracted golden eagles from the mainland to the Channel Islands. And when the golden eagles got there, not only did they find there were delicious little piggies and deer running around, there were also tasty little foxes. And so they started predating on these foxes. And as soon as they figured out that, they were able to implement remedial measures, removing the golden eagles, putting in place captive breeding and reintroducing animals, and helping control diseases. And within 10 years, that species that was critically endangered became least concern, a dramatic population recovery. Right, so in my final two slides, I want to zoom out for a second. In 2010, the parties to the International Convention on Biological Diversity made a commitment. They made this big commitment to achieve an ambitious strategic plan for biodiversity with 20 associated targets. And we know that we're not going to achieve those targets. And over the next couple of years, you're going to be regaled with news stories about how we failed miserably to achieve these targets and all the rest of it. But I want you to be remembering, when you see those stories, I want you to remember and to think to yourself, what might the situation look like if we hadn't been doing what we are doing? The odds are pressures would be more severe. The various improvements that we've seen in protected areas management probably would not have taken place. And likely the overall deterioration in biodiversity would be a lot more severe. How much more severe? It's very difficult to estimate, but by some calculations, they could be at least 10 times worse than what we see today. Yes, things could be better too. So let's not kid ourselves. We have a significant shortfall in conservation action. By one estimate, we need an investment of probably $80 billion just to slowly start turning the site for species conservation. Now that sounds like a lot of money, but it's 1/5 of what we spend on soft drinks in a year. So it's not that amount of money. But we've also got to be smarter. Just like medicine, we've got to start using new technologies and start using new innovations to work smarter, more effectively, and more efficiently. Now, in closing, I don't want to give you an impression that it's all rosy and hunky-dory. Make no mistake, we are in for the fight of our lives. But as conservationists mount what is arguably one of the most daring rescue attempts for the vaquita in the Gulf of Mexico, as sumpter horned oryx are about to be reintroduced or have been reintroduced to the desert regions of Chad, as New Zealand's kakapo, a wonderful little bird species, enjoys one of the most successful breeding periods of the last 10 years, as we find new novel means of fighting emerging pathogens and diseases like devil facial tumor disease, which has completely ravaged Tasmanian devils across Tasmania. And as the UK experiences its first coal-free day since the Industrial Revolution, I hope you will agree with me that we can make a difference. Hope does spring eternal. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mike. What's been wonderful about today is just hearing firsthand from people who are doing amazing things for conservation. And we're going to hear now firsthand from somebody else about his amazingly ambitious project that he did with colleagues to help save the wildlife of South Georgia by getting rid of the very cause of its demise. So I'm going to ask Tony Martin to tell us his story of conservation success. Thank you, Tony.
Thanks, Rosie. Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone. First, the bad news. For thousands of years, we humans have been harming the planet, both directly and indirectly, and particularly in the last couple of centuries, we've brought species like cats and stoats and rats to places where they never occurred before, and they have brought about absolute mayhem because the wildlife there evolved in the absence of these predators. How wonderful then to realize that there are some situations in which that damage can not only be stopped, but actually reversed. And we've already heard today some other heartwarming stories. And I'm going to give you another. I'm going to tell you about how an invasion of rats on the magical sub-Antarctic island of South Georgia was defeated. Those rats having been accidentally introduced by our seafaring ancestors. And I'll show that the island is now being reclaimed by millions of birds whose own ancestors were displaced, actually eaten alive, by these invaders. It's a thrilling tale of how centuries of furry domination have been turned back in just the space of 5 years. Where's South Georgia? Well, it's, let's go back one, giving the game away. This is South Georgia here, and I just wanted to show you this slide to demonstrate that eradications of rodents are now pretty much commonplace. They're gaining more and more ground internationally, thanks mostly to the Kiwis and New Zealanders, who have been saving their native wildlife for decades. South Georgia happens to be the most southerly of all of the eradications that have been carried out, and it's also by far the largest. My own awareness of South Georgia came, I think, in the 1970s, early 1980s, when a chap called David Attenborough went down there and brought back remarkable, mesmerizing film of the wildlife there. And I remember thinking at that time that at some stage in my life, I really want to go there. And it's been my privilege to go there indeed many times. This photograph, I suspect, was taken on Bird Island, which is memorable not only for the wandering albatrosses, but also for its toilet. The Bird Island toilet is epic, and it's memorable. Epic because it's situated on the end of a little jetty, and memorable because in order to get there, you have to wade through thousands of the most ferocious seals in the world. So you've really got to need to go in order to go out to the toilet. So this is South Georgia. It's a UK overseas territory. It's 170 kilometers from end to end. That's a map of Greater London to give you some idea of scale. That's 100 miles in old money. So this is a substantial chunk of rock in the Southern Ocean. That's what it looks like from 10,000 feet from the western end. And actually, this is one of those rare dingle days that even Sir David, I suspect, has not seen on many occasions, where you can actually see the very far end of South Georgia here from the western end. That's 100 miles you can see. I mean, you'll notice that most of the island is glaciated. It's only on the north coast where there's much space, land, which is ice-free, and that's where all the wildlife is, or at least was. Quite rightly, South Georgia is known today for its mega animals, here king penguins, and there are thousands of people visiting every year. What they don't realize is that what they're seeing is just the tip of an iceberg. What was there when Captain Cook discovered the island in 1775 is mostly gone. Most of the iceberg has melted away or actually been eaten by the rats that were introduced. Here's a young... This is a young albatross here, and these are two of the small birds which have mostly been eaten away over the last couple of centuries. The one in the bottom left is the endemic South Georgia pipit, found nowhere else in the world. And this is one of the species that simply cannot live where there are rats. They've been banished to the offshore islands. So now, can we have the lights down, please? I want to try and demonstrate to you the difference between areas with and without rats. Let me take you on a dark night, one of those rare windless nights, to mainland South Georgia, and we're up a few hundred feet, and this is what you hear. Absolutely nothing. But then next night we go out in a zodiac a couple of kilometers offshore to one of the rat-free islands, and this is what we hear. It's an absolute cacophony of sound. This is the real South Georgia. This is what rats have exterminated. These are the literally millions of birds that once came into this rock in the middle of the Southern Ocean and used it as home. There are now a few hanging on in the offshore islands, and what we're intending to do in this project is to bring them back to the main island. The rats were introduced accidentally by sealers and then whalers. South Georgia was the epicenter of world whaling for the best part of a century. And in case you think rats are cuddly little innocent things, here's one, some footage of one killing a chick underground. And this happens millions of times every year. So how do you pick out the bad guys, the rats, without killing all of the good guys, the other birds that you want to preserve? Well, the answer is you use conservation forceps to pick out the bad guys. And this particular conservation forceps was once owned by Jackie Onassis, can you believe? And it went on to be a Thames air ambulance before we bought it and sent it down to South Georgia with two other aircraft. And this is what the helicopters are spreading. This is a rodent bait. And one of those is a lethal dose for a rat. Underneath the helicopters are these hoppers, and they spread the bait evenly and thinly. And so in an area like this, there may be four bait pellets. It's not as though it's a carpet of bait. You're just wanting to make sure that you put one bait pellet in the territory of every rat on the island. We control the helicopters by GPS to make sure there are no gaps. And you can see on the right-hand side these lovely straight lines. These are the Kiwi pilots. And the wobbly lines here are the British pilots. So unfortunately, we had to abandon the British pilots and get only the Kiwi pilots to do the bait spreading work. We did the work over 3 years. South Georgia is so monumental, we couldn't do it in one season. We started off in the central north coast. That's 50 square miles. That was the equivalent to the largest eradication previously carried out. Then the next year we went up to the northwest. That was a huge effort. And we finished in 2015 down here in the southeast. We had to take everything on a ship because there are no airports on South Georgia. It's very remote. Here we are loading one of the helicopters and we had to put the bait. Incidentally, the Ernest Shackleton here, you may have heard, is going to be replaced by another polar ship called the Sir David Attenborough. When we got to South Georgia, it was remarkable to see all three aircraft, something like Apocalypse Now, these aircraft descending on the island. First, we had to offload all of the gear, 300 tons of bait over three seasons. And then we started the baiting, and we just kept at it from dawn till dusk whenever the weather was flyable. It took some pretty hair-raising flying, a lot of gusty winds, and we had to get a pellet to everywhere where a rat could possibly live, including the sides of cliffs like this. And to give you some idea of what it's like, I'll just stop talking and you can watch for a minute. After we finished the baiting, I had a couple of weeks in 2015 when we were able to fly around and have a look at the areas that we had treated in the two previous seasons to see how well the baiting had worked. And it brings a lump to my throat every time to see this image, because wherever we stopped, the sound of the blades would dim, and then we'd start hearing the sound of wildlife, and almost always the first sounds we heard were of the South Georgia pipit, in places where pipits had not been seen in our lifetimes, probably hadn't occurred for 200 years. These little birds were coming down to investigate these monstrous, noisy devices which we had used to clear South Georgia of rats. And now there are pipits breeding just about everywhere. There's a plague of pipits. It is so exciting. I can't tell you how rewarding that is after such a lot of time and effort on the part of so many people. Not only have the pipits come back, but the endemic pintails, again found nowhere else. When I was down there last couple of years ago, there were larger flocks than had ever been seen before. Everything is responding to this new freedom, including the Wilson storm petrel, a sparrow-sized bird which migrates up to Canada and goes all the way back down to South Georgia again every year. Again, this bird simply cannot breed in the presence of rats. So what have we learned from this project that has occupied my life for the last 7 years? Well, excitingly, this project, the largest of its kind, was carried out not by a large NGO or a government, but by a small British charity, and thousands of people who contributed to pay for it, so £7 million over 5 years. And these are people who wanted to leave South Georgia just a little bit better than when they themselves first saw it. And my own lessons, well, firstly, that even the most impossible conservation situations, things that look really dire, can be reversed given determination, goodwill, and a can-do attitude. And secondly, that nature is remarkably resilient. Give it half a chance and it will bounce back. Thank you very much.
It's now my great pleasure to introduce Debbie Payne. And Debbie, and along with her colleagues, I think has done more than anyone I know to help save species from extinction. So if you want to know how to save a species from extinction, please talk to Debbie after her talk. And I would like to say she often takes a much less murderous approach as well. So thank you very much, Debbie.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's a huge pleasure to be here. And I'd just like to start by talking about a few of the species that we might have lost. So far we've lost about 150 bird species due largely to human activity, and 217 are critically endangered, so right on the verge of extinction. Some of those may already have gone, including this species, the slender-billed curlew. And before I talk about recovery, I'd just like to show you a very brief video of this species. It's the slender-billed curlew at Merjezerga in Morocco, taken in about 1990. Which is when I saw three of probably the last individuals of this species on Earth. And it hasn't worked. Oh. Now that's one of the saddest things that's ever happened in my life, having seen a species that I know is now probably extinct. But one thing that it does do is it gives you great determination to make sure, or at least to do everything you can to make sure that this doesn't happen to other species. So can we reverse this trend? And I just want to show you a couple of things here. These motley specimens are arguably the rarest and most endangered duck on the planet, the Madagascar pochard, and the same thing for waders, the spoon-billed sandpiper. So are those the only ones that you or your children are ever going to have a chance of seeing, or will you have a chance of seeing them in the wild? Well, I think you will, and I'm going to give five examples now of species recoveries that give you some of the reasons why. And I'll start with the spoon-billed sandpiper, this tiny little bird here. Breeds in far northeastern Russia, A on the map here, migrates an epic 8,000 kilometers to winter off the coast of Myanmar and Bangladesh, C on the map. And in the decade to 2009, it was declining at 26% a year. So it really should be extinct by now. Threatened by two main things, the loss of mudflats, intertidal habitats during that long migration that it needs to feed on. They're being reclaimed for industry, agriculture, and tourism. And trapping of waders on its wintering grounds in Myanmar and Bangladesh by very poor local communities, trapping all waders for food. So what's been done to get this species to recover? Well, the conservation community across the world came together, many organizations, to do a whole range of things. A lot of advocacy has been done to identify and save the most important intertidal areas, and a lot of work with local communities to provide better and alternative livelihoods to bird trapping. That's been very successful. But we knew that with a decline that rapid, we probably needed a safety net captive population. And so the team at WWT, with many others, went up to northeastern Russia in 2011 to do something that had never been done and take eggs from the wild, bring them back to our headquarters at Slimbridge to set up that captive population. But one thing that I think has been at least as important is the intensive management in the wild in Arctic Russia. And that's, well, you've got a pair of birds that lay 4 eggs a year, but it takes them 2 years to fledge one young. And that's because predation on the eggs and chicks is so high. But we know that if we take eggs, we incubate them in incubators, we put the chicks in big outdoor aviaries, and then release them when they can fly, we can do more than 5 times better. So we've been doing that for a number of years and have released 111 birds to supplement the estimated population of 100 pairs at the time. And that's bought time for those conservation measures to take effect. And that's working. I'd like to move on to a group of birds that I worked on many years ago when I was at RSPB, the Asian gyps vultures. There are 3 species, and these are obligate scavengers. They feed on large ungulate carcasses like cows. And there were tens of millions of them in the Indian subcontinent because their food was so abundant. And that's because cows are considered sacred in India, so they're not killed, they're allowed to die naturally, skinners skin them, and the vultures would come down and eat their flesh. But those vultures declined by over 97% between 1992 and 2007. That's phenomenal. And research showed that that was because of a drug that was used as a welfare drug for sick and old cattle called diclofenac, a pain-killing anti-inflammatory. If the cattle died with enough of that in their tissues and the vultures scavenged them, the vultures would die too because they're super sensitive to that drug. So to help save this species, captive breeding was set up and all 3 species are now breeding successfully and can be released into the wild. But of course, the environment has to be free of diclofenac. So we realized we had to find an alternative to diclofenac that was out of patent, that was safe to use for vultures, that was effective, and after a lot of work found one called meloxicam. And shortly afterwards, the governments of India, Pakistan, and Nepal banned the veterinary sale of diclofenac, which was brilliant, and they did that really rapidly. This shows this graph, just one of those species, the oriental white-backed vulture, which is beginning to show possibly the first signs of a turnaround. The other 2 species, their declines have been stemmed as well. So again, that's great. And now on to what is one of my favorite birds on the planet, the kakapo. This is a flightless, nocturnal, 3.5 kilogram, slightly smelly parrot from New Zealand. I've had it nibble my ear, I love them. And this species was, a population was rediscovered in New Zealand in the 1970s with about 160 individuals, but declining very rapidly due to introduced mammalian predators like stoats and cats and dogs. And the avifauna of New Zealand evolved in the absence of those predators, so it's very naive, and particularly flightless species are affected. The New Zealand Department of Conservation realized that it couldn't remove the threat, couldn't remove all of the mammalian predators from the main islands, so it removed the kakapo and took them to little offshore islands where habitat had been restored, that were predator-free, and did very intensive management to try and bring this species back. And this graph shows you just how successful that's been. It was declining very rapidly in green at the beginning when the population was rediscovered. Peaches, the translocated birds, and red shows how it's going back up as quickly as it went down, which is great. Mike's already mentioned the Mauritius kestrel, but I love this example because how can you bring a species back from one breeding female? And it's not the only example. The Chatham Island black robin is the same. There was just one breeding female. 1974, just 4 birds threatened by DDT, which was used in the 1950s widely, by habitat loss, by introduced predators. And Carl Jones is a person who never says never, went out and did a whole range of things working. He works for Durrell, but also with the Mauritian Wildlife Foundation at the time, doing things like captive breeding, getting birds back into the wild, taking eggs from wild birds so that they carried on laying, providing nest boxes, and that all important habitat restoration and conservation. And there are now more than 100 times more than there were, which is brilliant. And last but not least, the Madagascar pochard, a species that we at WWT work on with Durrell and other partners. And this has the dubious distinction of being thought to be extinct probably twice. First of all, after the 1960s, when none were seen until a bird was rediscovered in 1992, single individual. Then no more birds were seen until 2006, when the Peregrine Fund, an American organization, inadvertently came across them at a very remote lake in northern Madagascar. So we sent our team with Durrell's team out there in 2009 to this small population and found that there were only 6 females in the over 20 birds, so an effective breeding population of 6 pairs. We don't know why Madagascar pochards declined, because they declined massively such a long time ago, but we know that their wetland habitat's threatened by many different factors. So the first thing that we did was to go out and take some eggs to try and set up a captive breeding population so that birds could be reintroduced. That was difficult but very successful, and there are now over 60 birds in captivity. Madagascan aviculturalists are very, very effectively managing that, and we can produce many more. But we needed to know why they weren't doing that well on the lake, so there was a lot of research, and it was found that that lake is really suboptimal. It's not an ideal habitat. It's too deep for the ducklings to feed. So of maybe 100 ducklings a year, only one or two were surviving. And the birds probably hung on there because it is very remote, not used by humans, no fish in the lake. So we realized we had to find an alternative site and came up with this site on the top right, Lake Sophia. Not in brilliant condition, but not bad. About 12,000 people living around the lake and local communities. And we're now working with those communities to both improve the livelihoods of those people and at the same time restore that lake so that pochard can be reintroduced, and we hope that will happen next year. So here we've got just five examples, very different species, some different problems, and all of those species have either recovered, are recovering, or the populations are beginning to turn around. So really, really positive results. And I could actually have picked examples from about another couple of dozen species. Generally, when you put the effort in, you can make the difference. But should we? Why should we save individual species? We probably all think, well, we should just do this anyway. It's the right thing to do. We want a rich environment. We're morally obliged to do this. But people often say to me, is individual species conservation the most cost-effective thing to do? Well, I think it's one of a suite of things we need to do, but it can actually be pretty good value when you think of all of the other things you get from it. So by tackling a threat like trapping for the spoon-billed sandpiper, you tackle that threat for the whole suite of other species that are being trapped. So we've got 50 million migratory water birds that share its migratory flyway. You're helping a whole bunch of those species too. For four of the five examples I've given you, habitat restoration and conservation on a large scale has resulted from those projects. And that helps not just that one species, but all of the species that use those habitats, and also the people associated with them. I've given you a couple of examples of how local livelihoods can improve, and I could talk for hours about how we're doing that, but in a whole range of ways associated with those projects. And if you have diverse and rich environments, they're more stable, they're more resilient for both wildlife and people. And things like the kakapo provide fantastic flagships for conservation, I think. And just to finish, I've talked a lot about the benefits here of saving species, but what are the costs of letting species go? And I'd like to give just one example. So some economists, led by Mark Hander at Bath University, estimated the costs, just one of the costs, of losing vultures in India. So an estimated 40 million vultures consume about 12 million tons of livestock a year. They declined to tens of thousands, and we had super abundant livestock carcasses. The other main scavenger of livestock carcasses are feral dogs, so they increase massively, which leads to an increase in dog bites, and an estimated potential 50,000 more people over 15 years in India could die of rabies. And that's got an estimated cost of $34 billion to the Indian economy. That's just one of the costs. So we shouldn't let species go. A healthy environment, healthy wildlife, and healthy people. And I'd just like to finish by dedicating this talk to a couple of my conservation heroes. Don Merton, who worked for the Department of Conservation in New Zealand, and Carl Jones at Durrell. These two men really pioneered some of the techniques, and their organizations pioneered some of the techniques to save these critically endangered species. They never said never, they're really inspirational, and they both brought species back from just one breeding female, which is incredible. But they couldn't have done that without really good teams of dedicated people working with them. And those good teams of dedicated people couldn't do their job without all of you, without all of the members of the public, all of the students that care about conservation, that do small things to make a difference, that volunteer, that promote these stories on social media. So I dedicate this to Don and Carl, also our own head of conservation breeding at WWT, Nigel Jarrett, a bit younger but in the same mould, but also to all of you. You're all conservation heroes if you make a difference. So thank you so much. Thank you to all of the organisations. This is just some of them involved in those recovery projects. So can we bring species back from the brink? Well, we have, we must, and I'm absolutely convinced that together we will. Thank you.
Thank you. So before I introduce the next speaker, I would just like to ask you all to thank our previous three speakers who I didn't think you could become more optimistic during today, but I mean, after each talk I've heard, I have done. So I'd like you all to join me in thanking our last three speakers. It's now truly an honour for me to introduce somebody who needs no introduction, not least because of the number of slides he has appeared on during the talks today in Earth Optimism. I'd like to introduce Sir David Attenborough, who's done more than anybody to bring the wonders of the natural world and our planet into everybody's lives, and by doing so, persuading, convincing us why we should all do something for nature. And I'd like to invite Sir David to share his thoughts on why we should be optimistic. Thank you very much, Sir David.
Thank you. Thank you. Today is Earth Optimism Day. Quite right, too. We've heard marvelous stories of heartwarming successes. Splendid. And if I may say so, Tony Martin, that picture's of South Georgia and what you did for those rats, that warmed my heart. Okay, let me indulge myself and just add one further glorious piece of optimism, as far as I'm concerned. Happened only 2 days ago. 60 years ago, I went to Borneo for the first time, and I traveled down a river called the Kinabatangan in northeast Borneo, in Sabah. And it was a revelation. I'd never been to the Southeast Asia before, and I saw fantastic animals. Orangutan, proboscis monkeys. One of the great thrills of that trip were pygmy Borneo elephants, which I didn't see, but we went into a very thick forest and we found a rock buried in the vegetation. And I sat on the rock, and in this thick forest, I could hear forest elephants. And they came right down below me. And I could hear the snuffly noises. I could even, perhaps this is my imagination, but I truly think I could hear them, the indigestion, the glowing stuff. Memorable. Fantastic. And I went back to Borneo a year ago, 18 months ago. And I went back to the Kinabatangan River. And I went down the river. And there was the rainforest on the side of the banks. But it wasn't quite what I remembered. There are often 8 species of hornbills, for example, in Borneo. And although I can't swear that I saw all 8 of them 60 years ago, I did see several. But this rainforest was a bit impoverished. And the day after that, we got in a helicopter and we flew along the Kinabatangan River. And as we rose up in the helicopter, I saw that along the banks, this rainforest was perhaps 50 yards wide, 100 yards wide. Beyond it, a monoculture of palm oil palms, oil palms. just stretching as far as the eye could see in serried, military, sterile ranks. And nothing else in that forest. And that was pretty gloom-making. And what was even more gloom-making was to hear a few months ago that part of that forest which did remain down in the lower reaches of the Kinabatangan was going to be bisected by a huge bridge which would go across the river and bring traffic into that part of Borneo. And I knew in my heart that if that happened, that last patch of Borneo, which still had not yet gone, succumbed to palm oil, it was going to be the end of it. 2 days ago, in London, the chief conservator of forest in Sabah said to an assembled company that he, leading his government, had decided to abandon the Kinabatangan River Bridge. It was marvelous news that a government of Malaysian Borneo had decided to take note of what conservationists were saying around the world and do something about it. That's my good piece of news. And you, as I have today, but not yesterday, you have been hearing other marvelous examples of what is happening. But at the back of my mind, and maybe at the back of your minds, there's a voice which says, yes, but what about climate change? What about rising population? What about the fact that, say, 60 years ago when you were in the Kinabatangan River, there were, compared with that day and today, there are 3 times as many human beings on this planet? What about that? What about the rising sea temperatures that are causing coral reefs to bleach all along the east coast of Australia? What about that? What's the difference? Well, the difference is that what we've been hearing about today and yesterday are the marvelous examples of what individuals, small associations of enthusiasts, in some instances big companies, but essentially small groups of people have been doing, and they're wonderful successes. But the worries that worry me now are the worries that can only be dealt with by international cooperation. No longer just a big company, but an enlightened company. No longer just indeed a one particular administration in the government. This can only be dealt with by people getting together worldwide and agreeing to do something. Now, that's a very rare thing to happen. When has it happened that people worldwide have got together and agreed on anything? It hasn't, except once. 60 years ago, about the nation's conservationists like you got together and persuaded people that whales were being exterminated, that people worldwide were sweeping the oceans and with new techniques of devastation and murder were eliminating great marine mammals, and that something had to be done. If we went on plundering those whales, they were going to be exterminated. But no nation could do it by itself. And all the maritime nations did get together. They did agree to do something. And the result was that today, whales are now back in the oceans of the world. So it can be done. The problems that the nations of the world now face, not just in the Indonesian Borneo or South Georgia or wherever, but worldwide, they can only be done by international agreement. That's very hard to achieve. But the United Nations has been doing stuff about it. There have been successes. It looked a year last Christmas, it looked as though we were getting somewhere, that the nations of the world were beginning to see sense. They were getting together. They were going to agree on a way in which we could curb the outputs that are causing the accumulation of greenhouse gases and causing the world temperature to rise. I saw the chief scientist who was coming to the end of his career and who had led a British delegation in these arguments. And I saw the joy on his face when he said to me, "It's through. We are going to get agreements. We have got agreements. It now just has to be put into effect." Well, there's black news coming from the States, because those in power in the States at the moment say that this agreement will be torn up. Will that happen? I don't know. The president has changed his mind on certain things. Maybe he'll change his mind again. If he doesn't, we keep at it. If he doesn't, the conservationists whose work you have been seeing today, and hundreds, thousands more like them, will stick to the problem, will stick to the solution, will keep at it, will make us certain that the greatest treasure that the world has is its natural world, in all its diversity, in all its glory. We will keep at it, and we will tell our politicians that we require it. Am I optimistic? I'm optimistic because of children. I see a lot of children. Children write to me. I hear a lot from children. And it's my impression that over the last 60 or 70 years, the children of this world have become aware of what is happening and have become unquestionably supportive of the knowledge and the faith that the natural world is their inheritance and it's there for hand on to their children. I hope that is true, because those children are the people who have been doing the sort of work when their time comes that you have all been doing, that you have all been doing on this Earth Optimism Day. I pray that that may be so, and that the young people who are coming up, this next generation and the generation after that, will come around our international agreement and understand that it's no longer the problem of a small group of people, of dedicated enthusiasts, of skilled people. It is to the interests of humanity that we come together and we sink our individual differences and we make this the planet, not only for ourselves, but for everything alive today. Thank you.